So the objective tonight is to present a study that's been done by the Donahue Institute at UMass, paid for by the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, to think about the issues that relate to the Smith Vocational and Agricultural School, which is really a unique entity in the whole of the Commonwealth. And I can tell you, sitting in the State House, that we've actually dealt with some other situations that are analogous to this, but not identical. And so sometimes you have to come up with a very unique solution to be able to sustain and build and maintain something that's important to the community. And so vocational education's been here for a long time, but there are some variations within the theme, and some of those variations have needed some attention, and folks have had to come together and figure out what to do about their vocational regional school that they care about, because they wanted to preserve and maintain it, but the circumstances were such that if you stayed on the same track and the same model, you might find yourself in trouble somewhere along the way. And so the conversation here has been going on ever since I've been in the Senate, which is since 1991, and I'm pretty sure it started before I was in the Senate. And it probably started when I was in, no. But it's been going on for a while, and a lot of things have changed in that long while. And this was an attempt to provide some technical assistance and some ideas and information to help us think about how to preserve this important asset for our region in the context of what we're dealing with in the real world here. And so I'm not going to try to go over the detail of what is happening in the real world, because that's what the study is all about. The study also ends with some recommendations, not a specific single recommendation, but a number of ideas, and it sort of tips in the direction of a particular way to go, but is not intended to be the answer imposed from outside. And we value our independence here, and we like to work together to try to identify and solve our problems. And these guys, the Donahue Institute and the Department of Education, Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, new name, well, not so new, but new to me. And so they're not here to impose a solution. They're here to be helpful to us in guiding us in moving along the path. After we have a general understanding of the work that was done, the next stage is to think about what are the next steps. And so we hope that within this evening, which we'd like to target to be out of here at 8:30, but what I'll do as the moderator is at about 8:20 or 8:25, I'm gonna do a check of the crowd and see if we're close enough that we think we can do it by 8:30, or if we might need a few more minutes and people wanna spend the extra minutes. But basically, we don't wanna be here until dawn. And the subject and this conversation could go on for a very, very long time. But we wanna try to be efficient tonight and put the information on the table and then figure out a path forward. And so I'm going to introduce Jeff Wulfson from the department, and then he's going to call up the presenters who did the work, and then I'm going to come up again, and then we'll have a conversation and we'll figure out where we're going to go, and we're going to try to be out of here by 8:30. Thank you for being out of here at 8:30, or did I just do such a great job?
Thank you, President Rosenberg. I am Jeff Wulfson, Deputy Commissioner of the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. We still answer to DOE, though. And I just want to spend a couple minutes just giving you the perspective from the department of why we're interested in this. There's been a huge explosion of interest in vocational education in the last 15 or 20 years. What we found is that combination of high academic standards that we've created under education reform, plus the career education programs that we offer at our vocational schools, has really energized the schools, energized the students. The achievement levels of students is really going through the roof, and the governor, the Secretary of Education, Commissioner of Education have all said we need to expand the opportunities for career education around the Commonwealth. They hear that from employers as well, that it's helping to provide a pipeline for all of the emerging industries and businesses in the Commonwealth. But it's difficult and it's an expensive proposition. Very few school districts in the Commonwealth, you know, maybe Boston, Worcester, maybe Springfield, really have the resources to be able to run a standalone vocational program for their students. So for most of the Commonwealth, we rely on regional approaches to dealing with vocational education. And that's especially true when we add in the agricultural education component. Smith, obviously, one of our four agricultural schools in the Commonwealth, and those are all resources, again, that we want to make sure we're preserving for the future. I haven't been dealing with the Smith issues quite as long as the president, but pretty long. I saw Claire Higgins here and Frank Lamas, and they were the ones who introduced me to these problems and to the unique circumstances of the Smith School. And we've been, you know, sort of talking about it on and off over the years, but really it's only in the last year or two, particularly with the need for some new building work here at the school, that it's really focused us on the need to do more than just talk and really come up with a plan ahead. So I appreciate the mayor's leadership, Superintendent Peterson's leadership in saying, you know, let's stop just scratching our heads over this and see what we can do to put together some ideas. So with that, the department was very pleased to sponsor this study and to call upon our colleagues at the Donahue Institute at UMass that we work with on many, many different projects. Steve Ellis is the director of the Applied Research and Program Evaluation Unit there, and Ken Rock was principal researcher on this study, and many of you who are involved in vocational education know Ken is one of our retired vocational superintendents, one of our most knowledgeable people in the field, so we were pleased that he was on this project as well. We are going to present the report tonight. A lot of this information, for those of you who are very familiar with the school, will not be new, but we wanted to make sure that before we got into a discussion about where should we go from here, that everybody had a baseline of information about how the school's organized, how it's financed, who are the students who are coming here, what are the challenges that the school faces. And we hope, as the Senate President indicates, that this is going to be the first of a series of discussions that will ultimately lead to a strengthening of the school and making sure that we'll be here for another 100 years. So with that, I'm going to ask our project team to come up and give us a quick overview, and then we'll open it up for some discussion.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction, and thank you all for being here. It's particularly gratifying on a beautiful summer day like this. So many people are committed to this particular subject. I can tell you that when Ken and I and our other study team member, Sonia Bouvier, who's standing over here, you know, first took on this project, it was at the urgings of ESE. It was really presented as an imperative, and the goal and the desire was to provide objective information. So when we talk about the study, I would like to just take a moment, you know, to say what we were and weren't trying to do. And as the Senate President described, we were not trying to be prescriptive about what an appropriate solution would be, but rather we were committed to advancing the discussion and decision-making process regarding this school's governance and fiscal situation. And we knew that in order to do that, we would have to dig very, very deeply into a lot of details. And so we've conducted and presented an analysis of a broad range of fiscal, governance, programmatic, and also population questions, and did our best to sort those into organized conversations that would be there as a resource and a tool, because each and every one of them is both a driver for what needs to happen and also a set of critical considerations for any solution-making process. And ultimately to present a range of potential alternative governance and fiscal models that might be considered by any, you know, regional or local organizations, groups, individuals who are interested in advancing this question. Our study methodology, it was a relatively limited study, but by the same token, it did provide us an opportunity to go very, very deep in some areas. And we really tried to focus our resources on, you know, that core mission of putting as much objective information together as possible so you would have a reference tool that could help guide your thinking and decision making. interviews with key informants. Need to thank Mayor Narkowitz, certainly, and his staff, who were very cooperative in the interview process, as was Superintendent Peterson, the Board of Trustees. We had the pleasure of speaking with numerous informants from ESC who were highly informative, just tremendous knowledge of some of the fiscal and governance issues and policy constraints, et cetera. We also took time to speak with folks from the Lower Pioneer Valley Education Collaborative, and forgive me if I miss anybody else. The document review, it's documents and data, mountains and mountains of data that one might consider in this kind of a process. We tried to sift through, take what was most relevant, and provide it in a form that would be digestible for you. And a survey of larger sending communities, I'll just say that this is where we had to stop way before we wanted to. We actually believe very strongly that there's a need for deeper community engagement to talk about these issues, understand needs from multiple perspectives. In the report, there's a very preliminary examination of what some stakeholders in some communities think, but we would really advise further engagement on that count. The goals of the presentation tonight, I think very consistent in a lot of respects with the goals of the study. We want to share information and ideas. We expect that when we get to the public conversation piece, that this will become very much a two-way dialogue. We want to create that conversation among stakeholders and, you know, fundamentally make certain that everyone understands that a change is needed. If we're at a moment of opportunity right now, it could become crisis, and we don't want to operate from crisis. We'll look at the information. I don't know that we'll determine what kinds of changes can be supported by all, but that's where we want to get, ultimately, is to get people thinking about the changes and finding common ground and consensus so that you can begin to craft a plan to move forward with shared direction. And as I think you'll gather from our comments, we believe very strongly that this is a regional conversation. There are important players very immediately, but, Ken?
Yeah. Thank you. So Steve and I are gonna go back and forth a bit tonight. I just wanna note potential partners in considering changes to Smith, and most if not all of the partners are in the room tonight, which is great. Smith itself, Northampton Public Schools, the City of Northampton, all of the professional organizations, including DESE, and other CVTE schools in the region. And we can go a little more into detail about that as we proceed. But they all have a common interest in this conversation. And the more inclusive the conversation is, I think the more likely it is to generate a consensus for what should happen in the future about Smith. General findings, if I was to summarize them, we think Smith is at a pretty critical point in its history. And we'll go into some of the driving forces around that. When you look at existing structures, there's some question as whether the solutions can be designed within those structures. So some modification to the fiscal structures and the governance structures of Smith may be in order. So we can look forward or towards some degree of both fiscal and organizational change. I believe very strongly that any solution that's going to be viable is going to be designed locally. And by local, I mean the region. And certainly we're going to need our partners in the legislature and in DESE to coach provide information and help us design solutions, but fundamentally it has to be a local solution if the way that Smith operates is to be changed in a positive direction. And also because that process of change could take some time, that there may be some adjustments that can be made in the short term to resolve some of the conflicting issues in the community while longer term solutions are worked out. When we look at something like this, we try to start from a point of view of common interests. What is it that everybody would agree upon? And our interviews with sending communities, our interviews with both Smith and the city and so on, I think it's fair to say that these are interests shared by the community. How can we maintain Smith as a viable institution? From the student point of view, as Jeff Wulfson was pointing out, how can we maintain and provide even greater access to quality CVTE programs for the students in the area? On the financial side, how can we make both the revenue and the cost for sending towns and the revenue for Smith predictable so that people can budget in a fair way and move forward and plan for the future? And a key piece of that, which we'll describe, has to do with major reconstruction or new facility building and the kind of structures that would have to be in place for that and the kind of collaboration that would have to take place. And finally, in governance, to create an increased voice for sending communities, similar at least in some ways to what you have in regional school districts, and also a clarification of the unique role of the city of Northampton in the governance and operations of Smith.
So we probably should just stand up here together for a little while. So there are also some shared challenges. And so, you know, as we look at it, and some of these things may be well known to many of you, but on the chance that they're not, throughout the region, there's declining population of high school age students. It's something that's affecting everybody structurally, economically, and it has some you know, very powerful implications. We have an aging facility here. It's not the only building that is in need of major repair throughout the region, certainly. But you know, there is a need for renovation or new construction here, and that's an imperative. And there is a need in this region for quality facilities to serve the vocational and agricultural educational needs of students. Transportation is a major issue, certainly. It affects quality of education, cost, accessibility, and it is one that is shared by all of the communities that are in some ways de facto members of this district, which is not regional, but certainly has a history of serving a much broader geography than its charter would suggest. And you know, more than anything, we share, you know, the challenge of the complexity. You know, everything that every time Ken and I peeled back a piece of information, we found that it was more complicated than we thought. The interaction of district and municipal and state policy and fiscal practice policy and practice is just tremendous. And I think that, you know, the real concern here is that we worry that complexity will continue to leave us with a sense of inertia. And right now, as I described earlier, we really think that there's an opportunity, and we want to get to that opportunity before we're in full crisis mode. Driving forces. Well, why was it important to do this study? Why is there an opportunity for change right now? As I said, declining enrollment. That is fundamentally affecting Smith's balance sheets and its ability to provide services. Lack of a formal binding affiliation between Smith and its sending towns. Smith really doesn't fit either the regional or municipal governance model or fiscal model. Again, this just speaks to the complexity. It's a poor fit with MSBA, Mass School Building Assistance funding formulas. And that means that we can't get to a simple solution in terms of meeting the facilities needs of our students here. And the development of a competing CVTE delivery model was something that, you know, just emerges as a reality. And it's something that affects the catchment area and presents probably some real opportunities, but also some challenges that need to be fully considered as multiple players are involved in that conversation. Opportunities for change, you know, they were recently completed at the beginning of the study. The Chapter 74 regulations were still under revision. Ken is going to speak a bit about what the revisions resulted in and what the effects may be. Revision of Chapter 70 foundation funding formula. There's a shared sense of urgency among stakeholders. That was very, very clear. And, you know, we can see in the room today that we have a real sense of commitment to this on the part of the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education and the state legislature people and organizations who are committed to finding solutions. Ken?
Yep. So we'll go down to some particulars about SNF. And many or most of you may be aware of some of this, but I think it's important to sketch it out. So SNF is unique. It's regional in its the students who attend, but it's municipal when you look at most of the finances, not all of them. And really, the SNF Board of Trustees is a unique structure among CVTE schools in Massachusetts. And that's further complicated by the fact that it's both vocational technical and an agricultural school. When you look at the towns that send students to SNF, it's quite interesting. 33 of the towns have no formal affiliation with another CVTE school. So in some sense, that might be the natural group of towns that might find an advantage in considering regionalization. 25 of the 58 towns from this data those towns already have an affiliation with another regional CVTE school. So the students from those towns are coming for unique programs that are here or agricultural programs that are here. So for that first group of towns, this is the default regional vocational technical and agricultural high school. For the second group, it's really the agricultural high school of choice. About 16 towns in the last 10-year span accounted for 87% of the enrollment. So it is possible to identify a core group of towns who send most of the students here. Northampton, the host city for the school, their enrollment has dropped from almost 32% to 22% in 7 years. So that percentage is going down. And East Hampton in particular, their enrollment, they used to be the largest enrolling town at SNF, and that's gone from about 29% to 9% in that 10-year span. It's vocational, technical, and agricultural. 16 programs, three are specific agricultural, and about 22% of SNF students, once we, if you phase out, if you don't consider exploratory, which all ninth grade students go through, about 22% of SNF students are agricultural. So it's unique in that. The two other county agricultural schools are primarily agricultural, but SNF is vocational, technical, and agricultural. Enrollment has declined a little bit over the last 10 years. As I mentioned, a great reduction in enrollment from the previous largest enrolling town, East Hampton. At the present time, SNF is the smallest enrolled standalone CVTE school in the Commonwealth. I think this is important to note because it makes it particularly vulnerable to declines in student population or withdrawal of member towns who might be seeking their CVTE programming elsewhere. And among CVTE schools, by far, SNF has the highest percentage of non-resident students. Almost 72%. I can't emphasize enough how much I think declining enrollment in Western Mass is a driver for this situation. And we'll talk a little more about this. I don't think that there is a simple or obvious or easy solution, but to acknowledge that, and to acknowledge that's taking place in many, if not most, of the towns in Western Mass, and that's affecting the finances of schools and the enrollment of SNF, it's a huge issue. For some of the towns that otherwise would send students to other regional schools, the declines in enrollment over the last 10 years are really significant. 35% at Gateway, 42% at Mohawk Trail, 29% at Central Berkshire, 28% at Amherst Pelham. I think it's important to note that SNF is maintaining and actually increasing the percentage of students that it's enrolling of the available students. But the group of students that they can draw from is getting smaller, and the more successful SNF is in getting a larger percentage of those students, the more impact that's having on the sending towns. If we look at fiscal data for Smith, per pupil expenditures, which is one way of measuring what a school costs, at or below that of other Western Mass CVTE schools, even though it's smaller in scale. At or below state agricultural schools. If we look at target aid percentage, which is a key metric in the foundation formula, it's how much aid is sent to communities is determined in the Chapter 70 formula. Northampton's target aid percentage, that is the percentage of aid they can expect to get from the state, is actually one of the smallest of its member towns. And the implication here is if Smith were to regionalize, the other towns' target aid percentage is higher, and that would pull the average up, which could generate additional revenue for Smith. Above foundation aid, this is one of the charts in the paper. Due to the really good work of the legislature over the years, in general, aid is grandfathered for schools with a modest bump up on a per pupil basis. And the result is, when you have declining enrollment over a period of years, that you have what's called above foundation or grandfathered aid. Two charts in the study describe that, but it's a significant amount of money flowing to Smith. The non-resident tuition is set at or near the cap that DESE determines. So, and there's a chart that shows that in relation to all the other book tech schools, so it's pretty much in line with DESE regulations. And if you look at the school choice picture regionally, it's clear that some districts are experiencing significant losses of revenue through school choice, and that has to be a fiscal driver for them. So that's a little background. Moving forward, we'll sketch out quickly five possible avenues. One is to sort of improve the current version by clarifying some of the regulations and laws in the region around Smith's governance and finances. The second is to move towards a regional CVTE school district. The third would be a model where you move towards a regional district but have the budget established by the state. The fourth is the municipal CVTE district. And finally, if there were to be a regionalization committee formed, they could look at other options as well. So, recently, new Chapter 74 regulations were passed. Smith's status is not specifically addressed in those regs, and you can understand why. The legislature and DESE have to create regulations that address all of the schools. But because of Smith's specific situation, these provisions within the Chapter 74 regulations are having or can have significant effects on Smith. I won't go into details on each one. They're covered in some depth in the report, but the cap on non-resident tuition, the process by which eighth grade students are notified, the oversight of program development in the area, the policy around admission of resident students first, the capital construction and renovation increment, which begins to provide a methodology for billing sending towns for some costs of renovation, and finally the computation and billing for non-resident special education students. If we look at Chapter 70, again, there's each one of these aspects is detailed in the report, but there are specific consequences for the city of Northampton on the way that the net school spending requirement is computed for Northampton relative to Smith. Because Smith has one of the highest percentage of special education students in Western Mass, the effects of having a fixed percentage increment in the Chapter 70 formula for all CVTE schools is described. And finally, the low-income student inclusion in the net school spending requirement for Northampton. And the last thing is that because Northampton is the host city and it's treated the way regionals are for the purposes of billing, there is in effect a requirement. The effect is that the vocational increment in the Chapter 70 formula follows the students to Smith, and there is not a corresponding requirement in municipal CVTE schools that's the same. I know it's complex, but it's really a critical factor. In one way, it ensures that vocational dollars in the Chapter 70 formula follow the students to Smith. In another way, it may make Smith somewhat less competitive if competing programs are developed in the region. Regional transportation reimbursement. Because Smith is not a region, it's not eligible for regional transportation reimbursement. But there's a big group of regional schools that advocate every year successfully, again thanks to our legislators, for generous regional transportation reimbursement. For Smith, the sending towns have to access instead non-resident transportation reimbursement. And it's a smaller group, it's more vulnerable in the legislative process. If Smith were considered in regs or through special legislation to be entitled to this, it would make a significant difference both for Northampton and for the sending towns. So these are modifications that could theoretically be made, but they would still not address two key issues. One is the voice of sending towns in the governance of Northampton, and the second is how are you going to build a new facility, or how are you going to do major construction, reconstruction here. So those modifications to Chapter 74, Chapter 70, transportation reimbursement policies would still leave these two factors unresolved. So the model that most other sections of the state have gone with is the regional vocational technical school. It's tried and true. If you look at the map in the beginning of the report, Western Mass has a host of unaffiliated districts. The rest of the state is pretty mapped out. So they have clear sort of rules and regulations around relationships between all of the high schools and the CVTE schools. Quick advantages, you have membership, representation, you have the authority to take on debt, clear formulas for assessment, you can establish E&D accounts. They're essentially municipalities in terms of the fiscal arrangements. Manage your own revenues. Sending towns are guaranteed seats. You have very clear regulations as applied to regional CVTE schools, and you clearly qualify for regional transportation reimbursement. One possible approach might be to marry those advantages with a budget set by the state. For example, you might set Smith's budget at the average of other CVTE schools and agricultural schools. A solution like that would take the whole budgetary process out of the regional board, and instead they could focus on program issues, connections with the workforce, and so on. You have something close to that already because the state is setting the net school spending requirement for the Northampton, and it's setting a cap on the maximum rate for non-resident student tuition. A third solution that we looked at was the municipal CVTE school. It does not appear to be a good fit. And again, it's because Northampton is sending about 22% of the students, and you're serving 78% of the students from other areas. The municipal model does not ensure that the vocational increment follows the student to the school. Would not solve the problem of how you share the cost of a new facility, and it does not ensure a commitment of the sending towns to send their students to Smith. The report also describes some potential organizational changes to provide more access to vocational and technical education for students. And some of this is borrowed from models that you find in other states. Some of it is borrowed from the models that you have at the collaborative in West Springfield, Lower Pioneer Valley Educational Collaborative. Half-day programs, conceivably you could do at SNIT. You could do dual enrollment, perhaps, with Northampton High School because the schools are so close, sharing of programs. You might even consider that towns might not decide where the students go, but students might choose to decide. Some students might want a half-day program at a collaborative. Other students might want the Smith Weekabout full-day option. You might consider an 11th grade entry point. This is common in Vermont and New Hampshire. Students have passed the MCAS. They're more career conscious. They're looking forward to what they're going to do when they get out of school. Could we create an 11th grade entry point and fill some of the empty seats? Not just at Smith, but at other CVTE schools. Could Smith run satellite Chapter 74 programs in other schools? This has been done in the eastern part of the state at Blue Hills. You have a common administration administering programs that are delivered in other places. And finally, I know this last one's a little unlikely, but I had to float it. There's discussion of where students should be for exploratory now, and how are students going to access agricultural exploratory when they're locked into other exploratory schedules. Over time, could the region establish a common exploratory schedule? And then students could explore CVT programs in their primary CVT school and still have some experiences at Smith. Because we have in Western Mass a unique combination of municipal, independent, regional, and collaborative delivered CVTE schools, regulations are going to encourage one model or another. And it might be good for the state to do some research into the relative effectiveness of half-day, week about, 9th grade entry point, 11th grade entry point, and so on, so that schools and communities would have some information helpful to them in making decisions about where students could go. So I think I'm turning it back over to Steve here.
Thanks, Ken.
Thank you.
Okay, so, I mean, as we start to think in terms of next steps, one of the things that we were very concerned with, as I sort of foreshadowed earlier, is making certain that we're doing appropriate outreach to sending towns and stakeholders. I think there's multiple advantages to doing that. Obviously, we need to make certain that we communicate the findings of this study effectively. It is a difficult study to simply mail out to people and expect them to understand. I would expect that it would need to be a fair amount of outreach, explanation, and exploration with these parties. There may be a sending town advisory board that might be a structure that could be useful for helping to sort of bridge and create this interaction and allowing sending communities to sort of develop their own voice, but in an organized and coherent way, because as Ken showed you, depending on how you define the universe of sending communities, it's enormous. It's enormous. Formation of a committee to explore regionalization is potentially an option. That committee may have a regional focus, but it may explore things beyond regionalization as solutions as well. And seeking the input of professional organizations, so Association of Regional Schools, Vocational Schools, etc., might be very useful informants to the conversation, as well as stakeholders to the conversation, as many of the policy issues would likely have real implications for other members. And there might be more common interests found there. Compete or collaborate? Okay. We know that all schools, I mean, we said this is one of our shared challenges. And so, you know, it is very difficult in a world that, you know, we have these existing structures. Each is working to sustain itself, to do the very best it can for its constituents. And so there are naturally going to be clashes and misalignments of interest. At the same time, I think that in order to resolve a question of this depth and complexity, we have to find a path forward to finding common interests, shared interests, ultimately driven by the educational needs of students throughout the region and the need to sustain high quality programming for them. And yes, I think I've covered that. Whose role is it to design a better system? Well, I mean, as Ken, I think, has outlined, and as many of you who were informants to the study outlined for us, you know, right now, we don't fit within the existing systems. Ken has offered some possibilities for consideration. Some suggest whole-scale change. Some are more incremental. What the right solution forward is probably going to be influenced greatly, not only by what the fiscal situation is and the educational needs are, but also by the ability to find common ground and reconcile interests. The state is understandably reluctant. You already heard, not only are they reluctant, but they're respectful enough not to impose a solution. We certainly have heard that things won't change until there's an imperative, a mandate. We've already identified one locally, and everyone with whom we spoke really believed that a locally generated solution was going to be the most effective solution, the one that understood and took into consideration the needs and the strengths and opportunities within our communities. And clearly, that's all about having the solutions, the best solutions, being shaped by the people who are most affected by their outcomes. This was the point at which we thought we'd conclude our presentation and allow an opportunity for some discussion, if you'd care to facilitate.
Great. Thank you. Reporters in the room? Any reporters in the room? Sorry? Okay, very good. So I just wanted to establish that this is on the record. This is a public discussion, and you should just be aware of that. Let me see hands of people right now who have questions or comments that they would like to make. One, two, starting small, three. Okay, so I'm going to try to see if we can go till about 8:15 and see if we're far enough along in questions and discussion to be able to talk about potential next steps. So let's try that and see how far we get. So the order in which I saw hands was two. Okay. Who's one? There you go.
I'll be one.
Could you identify yourself? Please rise and identify yourself.
I'm Nancy Follinsby. I'm superintendent of schools in East Hampton. And so I wanted to echo what Steve said early in his report about how important it is for those of us who are sending schools to have a voice in this process. Because certainly any changes that occur with Smith Vocational will impact our communities. I was surprised just before I received the draft of this report that I learned that our district had been mentioned in the report, and no one had come to speak with me about that. Now I know, I think Ken mentioned that there wasn't enough time to do everything that they wanted to do. But I believe that it's very important for those of us, and particularly East Hampton, who is one of the important sending schools to Smith, to be involved in this conversation and in this process. So I welcome some of the suggestions that were made this evening about finding ways to bring us as sending schools into the process. Thank you.
Do you have any comment about what was said about East Hampton, or just the general that you're looking forward to engaging?
You know, I'm not able to remember the exact quote, but I think there was some comments made about the fact that we weren't as open to sending our students to Smith Vocational as I believe Smith Vocational might wish we were. We also do send our students to Lower Pioneer Valley Career Technical Educational School. And we do that because it is a half-day program, and we very much like having our students in our school for half the day and then send them off to vocational education for the other half day. It's a model that works for us. So You know, there are complex issues about why we choose to support the vocational choices that our students have, and I would like to be further engaged in that conversation.
Thank you, and thank you for letting me follow up that.
Yes.
Okay, number two.
Susan Wright, Finance Director for the City of Northampton. There's two things in the report that DESE and the state could help immediately with. The first is on page 41. Where DESE in the report actually suggests that for the purposes of these regulations, Smith Vocational could be exempt from the 125% cap. And the chart right above that shows that the 125% cap could have an impact of a loss of revenue of about $650,000 to Smith. So exempting us from the cap, I think, would be a really good start. The second thing has to do with the calculation of the low-income students. I know that wasn't really gone over earlier, but what's happening, as it says in the report, is all of the low-income students in the district, all of those 70-something percent that come from other towns, are impacting the net school spending requirement for Northampton. If the formula were revised and Northampton was only assessed for the low-income students that are from Northampton, as it should be, that would have saved the city about $250,000 on net school spending. So between implementing the not letting us be subject to the cap, that'll help Smith Vocational gain a lot more tuition, and then also help the city of Northampton by not penalizing us for low-income students that aren't necessarily ours.
Hey, may I respond?
Yeah.
So, To both comments, this is something the department's been wrestling with a lot lately in terms of the balance between wanting to maximize opportunities for students, but also recognizing the financial impact on the districts that are paying the tuition. And as Ken, I think, made reference to, it's difficult for us when we have to come up with a set of rules that applies across the state. I think we sometimes spend too much time worrying about the dollars, and I can fully appreciate, you know, from the standpoint of school committees needing to do that. But part of me would like to see us really offer more choices. I don't think there's a one-size-fits-all. Some East Hampton students, you know, I think I've been to Lower Pioneer. It's a great program, and for the students for whom that works, you know, we want to replicate that model elsewhere. But for other students, the more traditional model works well too, and the more choices we can offer, the better. The question is how do we do that without breaking the bank on one side, but making sure that the resources are there to support the programs on the other side. So we're wrestling with those issues.
Anyone else? Comments? Questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I wonder. Back in one of the very first slides, the pressures on Smith Vocational in terms of declining enrollments and the lack of sort of commitment of sending towns and so forth. Do you have any concrete sort of predictions about what happens if we just remain in the status quo? In other words, what does that future look like?
Well, let me handle that, because I've actually got two stories to tell, one success story, one not so much, that tells you how we're dealing with this in other parts of the state. Minuteman Regional Vocational School in Lexington is going through some very similar types of soul searching, where they have a lot of students coming from outside their region. They have a facility that needs a lot of work, and they have been unable to get the consensus among their 12-member towns on how the towns should pay for a new facility that will serve hundreds of students who aren't in those towns. And it's been very frustrating. We haven't given up yet, but the future of that school is in doubt. The other success story that I would share with you is Essex Agricultural High School, the old Essex County Agricultural High School, that 15, 20 years ago looked a lot like Smith. A facility that had not had much of an investment and needed major capital repairs or renovations, declining enrollment, Essex County government had been abolished, so it was sort of an orphan, and there was no ownership by any of the sending towns. In that case, with strong support from the legislature and some really visionary work on the part of local officials, we took three separate vocational programs, the Essex Aggie program, the North Shore Voc-Tech program that was in a cramped building in an industrial park, and Peabody High School's vocational program, and we combined them together into a new model, a new region. If any of you are ever in the Danvers area, I really commend that you go take a look at the new Essex Agricultural High School that opened up last year. I wish I was back in high school again after seeing that building. It is such a fantastic facility. Enrollment is up. Kids are excited about it. It's a great resource for the towns. So it just, to me, it shows if we're willing to think outside the box a little bit, not a totally parallel situation here, but it's the kind of thinking that I think we're going to need here.
I happen to have visited that school about 6 weeks ago. Blew my mind. Could not believe it. Could not believe it. Mr. Mayor?
Could I just dovetail on that with a quick comment? Maybe ask Ken to clarify, because the whole issue of building the school, I know that was mentioned in the report of renovating the school, and the fact that it doesn't fit in with the current MSBA model. I'm wondering if you could just maybe add a little bit more to that. I mean, I can speak to it. I mean, in terms of the fact that because we're treated as a local school district, the entire local share for a project would be borne by the city of Northampton.
Right. And that's what makes it impractical.
Yeah.
And that's why, you know, we work very closely with the school building authority. My commissioner sits on the authority board, and they recognize that these kinds of complex vocational schools and agricultural schools need a different solution. And again, it may involve some legislative help. The authority is willing to participate, but before they can just say, here's a grant, we need to address what's the enrollment, where's it going to be drawn from, how's it going to relate to the other programs in the area, how is the local share going to be financed, do we do it through a supplement on the tuition, do we do it through some regionalization, are there other methods? Those are the details that will have to be unique to the Smith solution, and then once we get that, then you know, we already have the precedent with Essex Aggie that the state was willing to contribute more than the normal amount, recognizing that these agricultural schools, agricultural programs, are really a statewide resource. So I think we've got a model there, but it's going to require some thinking on these issues before you're really able to go to the authority.
But that was a regionalization model?
That was.
Anyone else? Yes.
I'm Maggie Gifford, the vocational director here at Smith Voc, and based on what you're just saying with the model with Essex Aggie, there's been some discussion regarding Dean Tech in Holyoke, and I just don't know if any more has come with that about maybe a similar kind of merge with that.
Where you know, Dean has been on the commissioner's radar screen. I mean, it's one of our lowest performing schools in the state. Holyoke, you know, you all know the situation there. We the department, have just taken over the Holyoke Public Schools. We have a new receiver coming in, Steve Schreich, and he and I have already had actually some preliminary discussions and said, we're doing a lot of thinking and discussing around about Smith. When you get ready to start thinking about the challenges at Dean, we need to bring that into the conversation. It's certainly not clear to me that Holyoke has either the size or the fiscal capacity to maintain a high quality independent vocational school. That's something that obviously the folks in Holyoke and the receiver are going to have to wrestle with, but. As we do our planning here, that certainly opens up some opportunities that we need to be cognizant of.
Yes.
I'm Julie Spencer Robinson. I'm the president of the Northampton Association of School Employees resident. Are there any aspects of the Oliver Smith will that complicate future opportunities?
Incredibly, right? I mean when we talk about what makes Smith unique. It starts right there, and you know, we've had some conversations about that, and I've talked with the superintendent. You know, I think as we do our planning, we need to sort of be on two tracks. One, what's possible within the constraints of the will, because that may be, you know, the path of least resistance. But I don't think we should limit ourselves to that. You know, if there's a solution that everybody says makes sense but might require some deviation from the will, you know, we're certainly happy to go to the Attorney General's office and say, you know, what's our opportunities here? What's the possibility of getting a probate judge to give us some relief? But we're nowhere near at that point yet. We're cognizant of the problems, and we need to just be thinking in and outside the box on that one. It's there.
And the will has been changed before. I mean, there's precedent for it. I mean, the state law that created the current Board of Trustees, you know, there's 1932, I don't know what the year was, but 1926, Jack Cotton. You know, they had to go to probate court to make those changes to the will. During a similar period when there was challenges for the school and the governance and that was a change that was made.
I don't think any of us would propose any such changes lightly.
Yeah.
But we certainly should be aware that it's a possibility.
Others, yes, sir. Claire.
It's something I've been thinking about this for a long time. And it just seems to me that Smith Vocational is a canary in coal mine for the rest of the vocational system in the state. And I'm curious about what you're thinking, big picture. I mean, other states, every single town is affiliated, not every one, but many other, every single town is affiliated with some kind of regional district. We don't have that here. There's other places that are not affiliated too. Although I know it's more than we are here. I don't see a big vision for vocational education in the state in the way that we may need it, and how it integrates that into the community college system as the needs for workforce development change. And well, I think there's a need to solve this problem locally. I think it's very important to be thinking about it in a bigger picture. And the final thing I want to say is vocational education by its nature is more expensive than a regular high school diploma. It just is. And so when the superintendent of East Hampton says they're trying to do something different, part of that is driven by money, and I respect that. The state has to pay attention to that too. Vocational education is expensive. Then we have to figure out a way to relieve these small communities out here in Western Mass where 80% of their budget is going to schools already. And so two kids going to Smith Vogue has a huge effect on their life. Two more kids, right? So we have to think about this in some different ways. So anyway, those are my random thoughts for the night.
And we absolutely are looking at this as not just something that might work for Smith, but can be perhaps applied elsewhere. I think even though Ken said we've relied heavily on the regional membership model around the state, I think we've sort of reached the limits of that. You know, the largest vocational regional districts, you know, have a dozen or more members, and it becomes very cumbersome to get approvals for budgets for capital projects. And so we'd love to figure out some way that has the best of that regionalization model without the, you know, when you start dealing with towns that are only sending, you know, 10 or 15 kids, it's a different level of involvement than you're sending it to your academic district, you know, to the Frontier or Gateway or whatever. So it's something we're definitely thinking could potentially be a model for elsewhere.
Can I just respond?
Yes, go ahead, Claire.
Sometimes Massachusetts suffers from a terminal uniqueness. You know, we're the only ones who know how to do this stuff. Some other states have been grappling with this. There may be some other models, and I'm sure you're looking at them. And it may be as part of the work to figure out what to happen here. And I think you have looked at some of them, I know that. But I worry that we wanted, you know, we respect the history and traditions to an extent that we forget that some other people are way ahead of us. And they're getting new ways of educating kids out there, and kids are being successful because of it.
A very common model in other states that doesn't have quite the same colonial era reach into the local towns is the the state-run regional, you know, in New York they call them the Boards of Cooperative Education Services, where the state just draws lines, and the local communities are relieved of the responsibility of doing that now. When you get into Prop 2.5 issues, it gets a little more complicated here. And again, we have this tradition of home rule and local control, but I'm happy to think big if...
Yeah. Because what we have in a lot of different ways is in serving us as well to CHIP.
Yeah, I mean, our bigger challenge, bigger than even this, is as Ken mentioned before, large parts of the state that have no access
right.
to good career education, and we need to solve that problem too.
Sir?
John Lynn, a former vice president of the ACTE. I represented Massachusetts and 16 other states in the eastern part of the country. I've traveled the entire country. I've been devoted for vocational education for over 25 years. I've seen the delivery systems in every state. I was the person that, at one of the national conferences, brought up the fact that Smith Volk was the first vocational and agricultural school in the country. 1844 was when Oliver started. 1834 was when Oliver started, and he stopped in 1844 writing a will. He actually did, if you read the will, and I've read it many times over and over, simply because I needed to be knowledgeable when people asked me about this school anywhere in the country to explain its uniqueness. I believe that he actually did create a regional school system. His idea was to bring in students from all over the region. It was actually a tuition and boarding school in his mind, in his concept. Obviously, that didn't work by 1905 when the school finally was, after 60 years of his death, after his death, was able to get the funds to start the school. The history of the school since that very point in time has always been the finances of the school. Possibly because the three trustees that were originally the people that accepted the funds from the trustees at the Oliver Smith charities, and actually these people are the superintendents in the will. When they accepted it, they decided to turn money back. I think it was a mistake, because that's the money that comes here every year, the interest comes here every year, and it really didn't help found the school. You know, sort of like starting a corporation without a good, solid financial backing to start it. Corporation is going to fail, chances are. So in this particular case, I believe that it was a regional school. I mean, this predates the Morrill Act of 1862, which created Mass Aggie. And when this school came on board in 1905, the people at Mass Aggie were worried that this school was going to take students away from them, which probably it did at that time. But the structure is such that I believe that this school should remain a secondary school, but it should have a post-secondary program. A good friend of mine runs a post-secondary program at Greater Oaks in Cincinnati. His budget is $75 million a year. Okay, postgraduate, that's for the adults. That's that night school stuff that most people don't realize happens at vocational schools. This was the school that was a model for that for a long time. And at one point in time, in the early 1990s, we closed the program where people used to line up out on the street just to come here and work at night. So that's the kind of school we're talking about. But here, on a different note, and to contradict, I think, a little bit of what the former mayor was talking about, I work in a shop that's state-of-the-art occasionally. I'm an independent welder. And when I go in there, I weld on projects that go out to Route 128. I'm not even supposed to talk about this. Keep that off the record. But anyway, the students that are in there, or the I should say the former students that are in there, are some of the most highly trained people I've ever seen working on equipment that could blow anybody's brains away. They're doing projects that I can't even begin to describe what they do. But they do this not having gone to a community college, not having a secondary, an advanced degree at a college. These people are working with very advanced computations. This is not just simple stuff. So I recognize that there's a group of students that come out of a school like this who are able to go into a career and fulfill the requirements of licensure and all those other things that are important for somebody to have so that they have the skill when they step into a job to do the job and finish it and complete it. So that's basically what this school has been doing for years, and it still does it as far as I know, because I've seen the newest students take over the positions in some of these companies and do that same kind of stuff. Across the country, there's all kinds of delivery systems. I remember when in the Rose Garden, it was Bill Clinton that told us he was going to do this fabulous thing with vocational education, and it was going to emulate what was happening in Arkansas. And in Arkansas, what they would do is a student would go to high school, and at like 1 o'clock in the afternoon, they'd send them off to a factory. So the student really, that was their idea of vocational education in Arkansas. So I don't think that that's really the kind of stuff that this state wants to have, because the people on 128, the people in Boston, the people around here that are inventing and are creating the future are looking to people that come out of this school and other schools like it who might have the skills that they can put in on a job and do that job. Companies, for example, Pratt & Whitney in East Hartford stopped educating people many years ago. I worked for AT&T. They stopped training people many years ago. I had training in a bomb-proof building on 53rd Street in Manhattan. It had two windows. They were fake. They said they could take a direct hit from an atomic bomb. Most people don't even know that it exists. But this is the kind of stuff that, as far as I'm concerned, I've seen it in my life, and I'm 67, and I see it happening in the future as long as we have people like the superintendent that's here and other superintendents that are pushing forward to make sure students have the kind of education they need. I'm sorry I'm taking a little bit too long, but you know, if there is a need to talk about this or to use my research, I have a whole basement full of it.
Thank you. Very good. One, two.
I'm Alan Seawald. I'm the city solicitor here in Northampton. I guess my comment and question are not specific to being city solicitor, but somebody who's been to many, many town meetings across the state. And I've never heard a town meeting complaining about not having enough representation. What they're talking about is spending too much money. And I just want to know if anybody has an idea of what would motivate a town to agree to regionalize when they're used to this model, what would be their motivation to take on the financial liability? We've heard the finance director describe what the cap is going to do to the budget here in Northampton, because this loss is going to be absorbed by the city. And so what would motivate these towns to absorb that loss or absorb the money that Northampton is now going to have to pay? And going forward, absorb, you know, the shared obligation for capital projects, for health care going forward, for retirement benefits going forward. What's the motivation?
I'd like to think that the motivation is to provide good educational opportunities for the kids in that town, but you're absolutely right. The dynamic that often plays out on the floor of town meeting is we've got our local schools and we want to fund that, and we don't show the same level of interest on the 5 kids or the 10 kids who are going off to out-of-district folk school. And that's, again, part of why I'm skeptical about the usefulness of the regional membership model to solve these kinds of large regional issues. You know, that works if you got, you know, Gill and Montague together, but I'm not sure it works with 20 or 30 towns.
Ken, did you want to follow up on that?
If I can just note that when the system of regional vocational technical schools was created back in the late 60s and the 70s, people had a vision and communities came together for a reason. And the reason was to provide a kind of education that could not be provided in local high schools because it was too expensive to have a machine shop and equip it with state-of-the-art equipment. I agree that it's a tough sell, but if we go back to this idea of a vision of what Smith could be and expanding the vision of what it is now and When I worked at Blue Hills, a big regional voc tech school outside of Boston, it really ran from 6 in the morning till 9 or 10 o'clock at night. And adults would come in and retraining programs were sponsored. I mean, certainly some of that was because it was in a semi-urban area where you have, you know, a lot of population. But part of it is also vision on where it can go. We had very strong post-secondary programs. So the comment about that, that's definitely within the institutional ability of regional CVTE schools to work on retraining and to run programs after school and on the weekends and in the summer. So I think it would be a challenge, but if the area could create a larger vision, a new vision, maybe even going back to the roots of what Smith was originally intended to be, perhaps towns would see an advantage with that if the financing could be made predictable and sustainable for those towns.
I'm Mike O'Kaelin, trustee of the board of Smith Vocational. And I attended the school, I'm not going to go back as far as John, but in 1964, and turn around and have stayed with it through an advisory capacity all these years, and then had the opportunity to take over from David Bourbeau when he passed away as a trustee, and have been elected for my terms. And the thing is that the bricks and mortar are a big piece of the school, I agree. I don't want to look at the mayor and say, you need to build me a new building tomorrow and take it out of your budget. We do have to come up with an agreement with the state. And I'm so happy to have you here this evening as our guest, Ken, for the fine work that you've done. And starting to identify for the residents of the city of Northampton as well as the surrounding communities, there's a problem. And it's not going to get better all by itself. Jeff is pulling his hair out, trying to keep things floating. The administration's doing a wonderful job. We're a level one school. You know, there's a lot of to be proud of in this Locust Street location. We've done some great things here. I need your help to help us in regards to building that model. I think that the superintendent's statement is correct. We need to do a joint model. Claire has fought this battle with us, and we arm wrestled for years trying to make it and keep it viable. But when I watch those children walk across that stage and get their diplomas, I was so proud to be able to say, I went there, they're going there. They walked out with not only a diploma, but a skill set that they can go and execute in any business or college, not only in the Commonwealth, but in the United States. And it's so important that this is the start, and only the start. But I just want to express the appreciation of everybody being here tonight, the appreciation of you folks coming, the hard work the mayor's doing, and the board, and Jeff and the administration. But it's a start, and I want to thank you all.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions? Yes? And so let's do two more. One, two.
Hi, I'm Martha. I just wanted to follow up on what the city solicitor was asking. I think I must have misunderstood. I thought that the financial advantage to sending towns to being part of the regional district was that their regional transportation costs would be subsidized. And that, I guess maybe I'm not sure about how that would affect. Are they now, their sending tuition would be different if they were part of the regional district? So I think I understand how the Northampton school budget works, and now I think I understand yours, but I don't know how a regional budget would work as far as are they considered to be paying their own, I don't know how you come to the number if they're saying their net student spend, the minimum student spending.
So for a regional district, and maybe you have to speak to this, for the member towns in a regional district, the budget is set by the school committee and then approved by the town meetings in the towns, and that leads to an assessment for each of the towns. You know, partly it's wealth based because of the state's formula, partly it's enrollment based. It is not necessarily cheaper than spending out of district tuition money. Depends on, again, what the district is choosing to do, how much above the state requirements they're choosing to spend. Transportation is sort of a separate piece of that. The region that has to provide transportation which you do not provide now for, you know, the sending towns have to provide it for students coming to Smith. But the state reimburses what's typically been in the range of 60, 70, 80% of transportation. So that's a nice incentive. May not balance out against the other costs, but that's a pretty steady incentive that the state has offered over the years for regionalization.
I'm Sonia Bouvier with the Donahue Institute. I guess what I'm looking for, wondering about, are the practical next steps from here, not so much in terms of what to do about the problem, but in forming a structure or a committee of some sort to
exactly what we
talk
do
about
as
the problem.
Soon as
that
we're finished.
Okay.
Fantastic.
Okay, so as long as we're going there, that's great.
That's
because
great.
There's a lot of people here who are committed and want a solution, but the path forward seems daunting.
Okay, so thank you for that, because that's exactly what we were going to do next. And so I'm going to ask Jeff, from Desi's point of view, what more can you offer in terms of helping us move forward?
We are here, again, not to lead the discussion, but absolutely to support it. Again, Commissioner, the Secretary, Governor have great interest in this as sort of a pilot project on how we can expand and strengthen career education. We have a lot of resources in the department. We have access to Perkins funds, so if we need some funds to help support a group. But I think what we're looking for the community to come together on is perhaps establishing some type of smaller working group with the key stakeholders involved, and we're happy to provide support, technical assistance to that group as needed.
And Steve and Ken, have you completed your work as of this point? So any future role would be worked out based on additional consultation and contracting and all of that sort of thing.
That is correct.
So your project is now complete. So we could think of this as phase one.
Exactly.
Okay. So phase two is to figure out structure and process to try to move forward to have this broad community discussion, meaning this region. So can the department, who actually selected these guys? Who did the RFP and contracted?
We work often with UMass Donahue Institute, so
with, so they're, was the they're, department they're, who played the role of...
They're our go-to folks on studies like this.
Okay. Yep. So are you in a position, if we asked you to do it, to go through a process and identify a facilitator to come back here
if that would be
for the purpose of having a meeting and discussion about how to create the capacity to move forward and have the public discussion that we want and have identify who the stakeholders are, what the process is, the timing, etc.
Yes.
So you could do that and come back to us with that. Does that work for you folks?
The other thing too, Mr. President, and I think you outlined it in your report, is I think we still need to do more public education, because we don't have, you know, we invited a lot of other regional stakeholders to be here. This is a difficult time of year. I appreciate the superintendent being here, but I'm sure many of her colleagues are wrapping up the school year. So we do also, parallel to that, I think we're going to try to the video of tonight's performance, of tonight's meeting, we're going to try to get out to all those towns, and because we really want to get more of them engaged in the conversation.
So it's not just a facilitation about structure, but it's also a facilitation leading to the public process that we would engage in for the public education and for problem solving. So can we, maybe I should just have some conversation with you about that, and then get back to, who would we get back to? We'd be getting back to the mayor, we'd be getting back to the superintendent, the school committee, trustees.
Correct.
Trustees, thank you. Is there anyone else I need to get back to when we have a path forward?
You got it.
Okay, and then we'll make sure it's public, what we're doing, so that others of you in the audience know what's going on. So two other quick things. I forget who you work for.
I work for Paul Mark.
That's what I thought. I just wanted to point out that Representative Paul Mark, staff person, is here, so I didn't want him to leave after taking all of this in without you knowing that he's also a target in this. So the other thing that I wanted to say is there is a window of opportunity here in a couple of regards. First, we have a new administration, and so we don't know totally what their direction will be, but it's a new start. So, you know, to the extent that they were old biases, they might be able to be set aside. And the second thing is that in terms of the legislative delegation, which is, from what I could tell, a big part of the success of Essex County was that the people locally got together, they created the vision, they decided what they wanted to do and what sacrifices they were willing to make, and then they went to the legislative delegation because we had to get things through the legislature for them that were at least, I mean, they may have been on the margins, but they had to be some change to help them move it forward. So you're positioned very well for the first time in a long time. Every one of the legislators who represents Hampshire County and Franklin County are in one or another leadership post in both the House and the Senate. So you have a window of opportunity, and let's hope that with the department's cooperation and with that team in the legislature, if you guys come up with something that we might be able to do what happened in Essex County. And I'm telling you, I went there, I was just totally blown away. It was just an amazing experience to see that school and see how they're doing what they're doing. And and 10 or 12 years ago, they were not there at all. So you can see what is possible when the consensus comes together. So with that, it's 8:25. Anybody want a final word? If not, we'll thank you all for coming, and we'll see you again soon.